Jeff Benz, there are various things I could say about Jeff Benz, most of which you won't read in the program. List of accommodations and experiences is vast, but he has traveled here today to be with you from London, has literally only arrived yesterday and is heading back very shortly. Part of the reason I wanted him here, because I think he's got very valuable experience to offer to you. So Jeff, with that brief introduction, I'm going to disappear.
Thank you, Steve. I was one of the original speakers at the first LawAccord event in Spain, where we had a three-person panel speaking to Dick Pound, who was the only member of the audience. So congratulations to Steve on making this a more robust presentation of law in the context of sport. I have a very broad topic, and I have the great difficulty of trying to make this interesting and useful. I view my role in this discussion of this topic as a segue into the next panel discussion, if not more. So we'll talk about some basic things and some things I feel strongly about. But unfortunately, I have not had time to throw up pictures or presentations or anything else, so you can hear me drone on for a bit. By way of background, when I was at the U.S. Olympic Committee, I was responsible for ensuring that Salt Lake City operated under its host city contract, and that we did the best job we could for the bids for New York City and Chicago, and like Salzburg, we didn't win. I'm blocking that out. I provide advice now to event organizers when they get into these sorts of relationships. So I've had the very good professional fortune of having been able to negotiate these kind of agreements with four clients, to advocate for clients when they get into fights over what the agreements mean, and to round it out, to sit as an arbitrator in disputes that arise between other people's clients about what do these fights, what do these agreements mean, and what are they about. And this has given me, frankly, a mix of a legalistic and a non-legalistic or practical considerations perspective, and I'll hope to share some of that with you. Sometimes contracts in sports are complex. Sometimes they're simple. Sometimes they're written. Hopefully not a lot, but sometimes they're not written. But always they're relied upon as a guide to go forward in a new venture. In some industries, contracts are very sophisticated and mature legal documents. In others, they're not as mature. But the relatively recent ascendancy of sport in commercial affairs probably puts sport in the middle of the contract sophistication timeline as I see it. Certainly, agreements regarding television broadcasts and significant sponsorships are complex, very mature, very well thought out, litigated, and operated under documents. Event hosting agreements are falling into that categorization increasingly, although this has been a relatively recent phenomena. So is David still in the audience? David Simon? Maybe he left. I don't know what happened in 84, but I do have a perspective on the games right before that I'll share about what these agreements look like. Before the 84 Olympic Games in Los Angeles, when Peter Ueberroth showed the world you could make money from hosting an Olympic Games, host city agreements were relatively simple affairs. I can speak as an expert on this somewhat because in 2001 I had to look up some IP rights issues for a certain movie that was being made using footage from the 1980 Lake Placid Olympic Winter Games. Those of you that are not American may not recall as much as Americans do who are of a certain age, those games were special for us because our hockey team had beaten in the height of the Cold War the Soviet team for the first time in a very, very long time. And this yielded the Miracle on Ice, a very well-known clip in our country and a very well-known event that happened in our history. I found the host city contract for those games and I was looking for it to try to guide me as to what happened to the IP rights over the footage related to those games. The agreement was 2 pages long. Now, I'm not saying length of agreement is necessarily an indicator of the quality of a contract or anything else, but in those days, that's what people thought was sufficient. Compare that to the current Los Angeles 2028 Olympic Games host city contract, which is 43 pages long, single-spaced, and even the World Beach Games 2019 contract is 15 pages long. So somewhere in that continuum, we as lawyers are getting our hands in there, and if number of words is an indicator, we're making more money than we did. But sports-related agreements provide lots to negotiate and lots to talk about. As lawyers, we can assist clients to think through the business issues and their risks. We can reduce these concepts to writing, and we can negotiate with the other side in assisting in the allocation of risk and ensuring that our clients reap the benefits of what will hopefully be a profitable business venture. Lawyers in sport agreements, drafting and negotiation are both legal scriveners and trusted advisors. And some have influence beyond just being lawyers. They actually are fixers in some way. Our clients at times don't always embrace this about us, but they should. We are not simply fungible service providers that you can get somebody off the street to do. Most of us have a value-added proposition that you should be able to find out, figure out, and be able to capitalize on to give you the best possible deal. I think that I come from a perspective called the common law perspective of the law. There are a number of civil law lawyers in the room. If you don't know the difference between that, maybe we'll touch on that a little bit later, but essentially they're very different approaches to the law, to different aspects of it. And in litigation and dispute resolution, it's very different in terms of the approaches. But I think in the creation of contracts and the like, we get there using different words, but pretty much the same common practices. One of the things I see quite a bit, both as a representative of parties in these deals and as an arbitrator I see these as a downside risk, I see this concept of boilerplate. And for some fundamental terms, using terms that have worked for you before in a current deal from a prior deal is entirely it's entirely efficient. In other areas, it's entirely ignorant. And so the business terms of each deal as opposed to the legal terms are rarely, if ever, boilerplate. They are new each time and they should be approached that way, and when they're not, this creates fertile grounds later for disputes as to what the heck the contract meant when the parties aren't getting along. Jamming a square peg into a round hole of a deal is not going to work. Do contracts need to be precise? Some clients immediately say, yes, I want my lawyer to make every term of my contract clear and precise. I want it to be watertight. I want it to be easy to understand. And I want it to cover all of the key points. Unfortunately, not all relationships can sustain the negotiation process that would have to go into creating such a thing, particularly in new areas, and particularly in difficult areas to define. And it's hard to get a business off the ground when you're hammering away on each other on getting down to a level of precision that may not make sense. So some things can be intentionally ambiguous. Conscious ambiguity is often an accepted way to address these things. Unconscious ambiguity, not so great. But conscious ambiguity with the understanding on both sides that we'll figure it out often works. So what are the basic terms that I think are important for a sports-related agreement in this day and age? From the change I've seen over time, this one hasn't changed. The rights given and the obligations accepted must be stated clearly. In sponsorship agreements, the categories, the licensed marks and marks usage, activation rights, access to the various assets of the rights holder, all of these must be defined. In event agreements, of course, IP and format rights, obligations as between the organizer and the event rights holder, funding for the event so it can get produced. We heard about some of that and how that used to work from David Simon and how it works now. And the responsibility for any losses or liabilities all should be clearly set out. The parties should consider performance metrics for various parts of their business venture to determine how to go forward based on success or lack of success. Describing the business model accurately, how does the money flow, how does the risk flow, that needs considerable time on it. And so, all too often, those are inartfully described, and I see those when they come in front of me as an arbitrator. How do you allocate the risks, how do you allocate the liabilities, and how do you deal with the legacy, hopefully, that you'll have at the end if you have a profitable venture? The big one I see that's been a big change in my experience in the time I've been involved doing this is the world of broadcast agreements. So everyone knows now that 12 years ago, we talked about new media rights in agreements, in broadcast agreements. In the IOC television agreements, they made reference to new media rights with the host broadcasters. No one quite knew what those were, but that was a placeholder for something's going to happen that'll be different that we don't know what it is right now, and we're going to allocate the revenue on that. We're going to split the revenue in some way on that. So 12 years ago when we talked about it, we didn't know what it was. 12 years ago, you didn't really download movies other than illegally pirated movies. There were no real apps for streaming video. Amazon was a company you shopped with and didn't watch video with or go buy your groceries from. Twitter and Facebook were social media hubs allowing exchange of text messages and photos, not displaying live events. You watched television on your television, which provided terrestrial or satellite-based broadcast of a variety of content, including sports events. What we call televisions today are high-definition monitors with an internet connection, and broadcast television, as we used to know it, is struggling to stay alive. As more and more consumers go online to consume on demand the content that they wish through streaming and other means. Sports has, to some extent, kept traditional broadcast television limping along, because it turns out in our business, time is an important factor. We are blessed, at least by the fact that people don't want to find out about an outcome and read about it in sports. They want to see it happen. And so that has become an important factor for why traditional broadcasters have been spending more and more money on sports events, because they have a captive DVR fast-forwarding proof audience. But now you have companies like Amazon, Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube branching out and offering live sports content through the web. They're acquiring rights in the United States for this kind of stuff. I've had conversations with two of those companies on behalf of clients in this very area in the last 2 weeks. And the concept of what they call over-the-top programming, or OTT, is becoming an important term for lawyers to be familiar with. This affects our sport relationship with host cities and with event organizers in the sense that oftentimes your broadcaster and your sponsor may converge into one and the same. It's quite easy to see how Amazon, which has a myriad of businesses in addition now to live event streaming, would make a sufficient sponsor in addition to a sufficient host broadcaster. That pitch is very different than when you make it to Sky or when you make it to another more traditional broadcaster, but it's something that I think we have to be thinking of as lawyers and be ahead of, particularly in this game. At what point does the broadcast relationship end and the sponsorship relationship begin? I think we're going to see more activity on that. Another area where I think lawyers have to take an active role and think ahead for their clients is what to do when there's trouble in paradise. So you have the beginning of a relationship when everyone's in the honeymoon phase and everything's going great, the deal is getting formed, everyone's talking about money, moving around and making a lot of money and running a great event. But that's the time when people need their lawyers the most to think about what happens when it goes bad. How do we get out of this deal? How do we unwind this deal in a peaceable, constructive, and pain-free way? This is not the time for simple boilerplate. It's not the time to go grab another deal and use an example from that deal and plug it into this one. It's time for thought. Are there objective milestones or conditions that work for this particular deal that tell us when it's time to get out or how to get out? Usually or often, one side in these relationships wants flexibility and one side limited grounds to get out, but occasionally both want the same thing here. You have to be careful how you define the trap doors for exit so that it makes as much sense when it happens as it does when you're entering into the relationship. Choice of law always seems to be a topic in these agreements, and at least event organizers will often put up a fight about it when it comes time to sign the contract or negotiate out the deal with the event rights holder. When an event is being held somewhere else or when a sponsor is based somewhere else, the organizing committee or the sponsor almost always want the law to apply to be that of the jurisdiction where they are located. They're more comfortable with that. They know what it is and how to deal with it and how to address that law in their contracts. Sports rights holders, like international federations, rarely want to succumb to the law of a local jurisdiction for disputes that arise relating to their agreements for the flip side reasons. They're not comfortable with the law there and the effect of the law on the various business terms that they've drafted. So imagine being the IAAF and being subject to the law of the state of Florida for an event. I mean, I can't imagine they would ever accept it. There is some pushback on this kind of stuff that happens in the process, but I recommend that that should be one of the least worries they have. It just needs to be defined as to where it should be. And that given the maturity and now the tremendous international commercial recognition of Swiss law, a Swiss law choice of law provision, or even in the case of the IAAF, a Monegasque law provision, and we have some IFs that prefer English law because that's where they're based, I don't think those things should become material terms that stand in the way of running a deal. Now, when the trouble in paradise ends up in a pitched battle, you need to have protected yourself in the drafting of the agreement. In the heat of battle is not the time to try to figure out, well, what do we want to do? Do we want to go to court? Do we want to go to arbitration? Do we want to mediate? You have to provide a backstop for yourself when you're in the honeymoon period, or it doesn't make sense. So do you think being in a local court makes sense? If you ask Apple and most of the tech industry in Silicon Valley, they say yes. They tend to litigate their disputes in state court in Santa Clara County, California. International sports, however, has over the last 25 years developed what might be considered a tradition of using arbitration to resolve their fights. And in commercial agreements, and perhaps more than in other types of areas in sport, arbitration makes a lot of sense. There's no international convention or treaty on enforcing domestic court judgments abroad. All you have to rely on is something called comity, C-O-M-I-T-Y, not C-O-M-E-D-Y, although sometimes it has the same effect. But there's nothing that requires a foreign court to recognize an award or a judgment that's made somewhere else. Not so in arbitration. There's something called the New York Convention, which is signed up to by the bulk of the world, that governs enforcement of international awards from arbitration around the world. It's wise to make yourself subject to an arbitration agreement. The awards and proceedings are confidential. The awards are enforceable anywhere in the world that you would want to enforce them. You get access to specialized expertise in the form of sports lawyers serving as arbitrators. Think about how many sports cases annually make it in front of a typical local judge anywhere in the world. Let's talk about one that actually gets a case. Maybe one a year. That doesn't give you a lot of confidence that they know what we do, what this thing is that we do, and how we do it. Perhaps the one exception to that is that if you're in Lausanne, the courts there have recently seen their share of IEBA-related litigation. Hope nobody from IEBA is in the room. Maybe they are. But that's the exception rather than the rule. That actually doesn't happen very often. So in arbitration, disputes can be resolved relatively quickly at lower cost than litigation, and arbitration is flexible procedurally. Parties can customize the process. They can pick how many arbitrators they want, how much time they want to have the thing last for, where it will be, et cetera. And the IOC has an arbitration clause recognizing CAS in their host city agreements. I know the World Beach Games host city agreement resolves to CAS, as well as a number of other important event hosting agreements. As you well know, with CAS, you get an international commercial tribunal with awards enforceable anywhere, and it has review. Its decisions are subject to review on limited grounds by the Swiss Federal Tribunal. So you need to think about that. When drafting those provisions, you need to think about how to do that. Every major international institution that you would want to have your case heard in front of has language on their website that you should just pick up, lift, and insert in the agreement. Now's not the time to get creative. Now's not the time to lift something from a prior deal that you may not have had a dispute on or not been tested. Now's the time to go be simple and grab that language so your case gets in front of the arbitrators that you want. Should you include a mediation provision? Some people insist on this. I'm of a mixed view on it. I generally don't recommend a mandatory mediation provision on the basis that mediation is something that's voluntary and the parties can at any time opt to go to mediation, no matter what else is going on in the case. Why make it mandatory? Why put that expense on them? And some people get even more creative and they have step clauses which say things like, if we disagree on something, Tom and Sally will have to talk about it, and if they still disagree, then the CEOs talk about it, and if they disagree, then we have mediation, and if that doesn't work, then we go to arbitration. Care has to be taken in that context to avoid depriving yourself of arbitral jurisdiction. That's called a step clause, and step clauses that don't tell you or don't make it clear when the prior stages end result around the world in you never getting to arbitration because you haven't finished the negotiation or you haven't finished the discussion between Tom and Sally, or it's not clear you finished the mediation even though you didn't have a result. Mediation is a process, not just a single episode. So you need to be a little clear about that if you want to make things complex and go that way. The only other thing I would say is beware the exhibits. Watch the exhibits. Sometimes you have harmless exhibits in these agreements like copyright assignment forms or trademark usage or guidelines directions. Other times you have more invidious exhibits like operating budgets, business plans, and the like that are often not written by lawyers, written by lay people. But parties come to have expectations about them and they become expressly incorporated by reference into the agreement, so you're bound by them. I see that my time is running and I don't want to violate that limit, so I'm going to knock it off here and hope that I've at least provided a little information that takes us into the next topic discussion with the panel. So thank you very much.